So welcome everyone to one more edition of our student algebraic geometry seminar at INPA. Today is our last edition of this year, and who will have the great responsibility to end this year of presentations is our mathematician colleague John Alexander, just kidding. And he took his PhD at Metropolitan Tokyo University. And after taking his PhD, he held postdoctoral positions at INPA, University of Oxford, and Max Planck Institute for Mathematics. And today he will talk about 30 years of mirror symmetry. It's a great pleasure to have you here, John, and please go ahead.
Okay, so thank you, Eduardo, and the organizer, for the invitation to give a talk here in this seminar. It's actually my pleasure to be in INPA again, at least online. And it's also, you know, it's very nice to talk to students. So that will be a great opportunity to meet, you know, young people interested in mathematics. So I will talk in English because my Portuguese is quite broken. It's more broken than my English, so I think it's much better to talk in English. But feel free to ask questions in Portuguese and also in Spanish if you want, no problem. So let me say something. This talk actually is a big overview. So I don't give details in during the talk. So the idea is to give a general overview of mirror symmetry and give you an idea of what mirror symmetry is, right? So I organized a meeting this year. I called that meeting with mirror symmetry in Latin America. And Senia de la Osa was one of the speakers. And actually, she reminded us that this year is the 30th anniversary of mirror symmetry. Probably I had to be more precise, and it's not really the 30 years of mirror symmetry, but maybe the mathematical interest in mirror symmetry. So mirror symmetry is something coming from physics, and it's quite old. It's not really that old, but it's older than 30 years. But mathematicians actually became interested in mirror symmetry from 1991, and I will explain why, and I will tell you why mathematicians now are interested in mirror symmetry and why mirror symmetry is one of the most active areas in mathematics at the moment, right? So let me start saying a few words about what is mirror symmetry. So during the talk, I will ask this question many times. What is mirror symmetry? So I think, I mean, I have to be honest, I don't know right now exactly what mirror symmetry is. So I have used an impression of mirror symmetry, and I think that's the situation in the field. So we have a lot of conjectures, a lot of pictures, and we hope that all these pictures and all these conjectures can fit together. But a definite answer of what mirror symmetry is quite open, I think. By the way, I mean, I don't pretend to be exhaustive during the talk, so I just give my approach to mirror symmetry, my understanding of mirror symmetry, and the things I like in mirror symmetry. But of course, mirror symmetry is too big in order to be taken in just 1 hour, right? So, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
The screen was frozen for a while. So, what is mirror symmetry? So, let's consider the first approach. So, we have a Calabi-Yau manifold of Calabi-Yau variety, X. You can consider any dimension. So, it could be elliptic curve, chitrous surfaces, etc. And if you have a Calabi-Yau manifold, you have two types of geometries. So you have, on one side, you have a symplectic geometry because you can see the Calabi-Yau as a symplectic variety, as a symplectic manifold. And then you have the complex geometry or complex algebraic geometry, if you want. because you have a complex structure in the Calabi-Yau. So you can have these two geometries associated to the Calabi-Yau manifold. So what physicists actually realize, just studying the Calabi-Yau trifolds. Why they study Calabi-Yau trifold? Because for string theory, and I will back again to string theory later, the important thing is are Calabi-Yau trifolds. So roughly speaking, you have in string theory, you have a 10-dimensional space-time. So you have the four-dimensional usual one, and you have this other six-dimensional space. And the six-dimensional space should be a Calabi-Yau. I mean, it's a trifold because if you consider compact dimension, so it will be a trifold. And that's why physicists were interested in Calabi-Yau manifolds. And physicists discovered that the Calabi-Yau came in pairs. So you have a Calabi-Yau X and Calabi-Yau X check. And the point of mirror symmetry is, and that's the main important point during the study, that you can interchange, you can relate the symplectic geometry and the complex geometry of mirror pairs. So if you have a symplectic, if you consider X as a symplectic variety, the symplectic geometry of X is related to the complex geometry of the X check, the mirror pair. On the other hand, if you consider the complex geometry of X, it should be related to the symplectic geometry of X check. So what I will try to do during this talk today is try to explain what is the meaning of this relation between symplectic geometry and complex geometry in the context of mirror symmetry, and how these ideas have evolved from the beginning of the study of mirror symmetry, right? So that's the main motto for today. So we have two geometries, and we have this relation, this strange relation between the complex and the symplectic geometry of these varieties, of these manifolds, right? So let me consider an old enumerative problem. So you can consider, I mean, so somehow mathematics is kind of activity. I mean, you have two main activities in mathematics. So you want to count things and you want to classify things, right? So this is a kind of counting all problem. So you have, a plane, you want to count the number of rational curves of degree D that actually pass through n general points. That's a classical enumerative problem, right? And in particular, if you have that the n is equal, the number of points is equal to 3d minus 1, where d is the degree of the curve, we have that this number is finite. I will denote this number by nd, and the problem is to find a formula for nd, right? But now we can, consider a similar problem. So we want to counter the number of rational curves of degree d, but not in the plane, but in the quintile hypersurface in CP4, given by this formula, by this homogeneous polynomial you have there. It's x1 phi plus x2 phi plus x3 phi plus x4 phi plus s5 phi equal to 0. So the point is that this quintile hypersurface in CP4 is a Calabi-Yau manifold, it's a Calabi-Yau trifold, right? So we want to count this thing. So that's very, very classical problem. It's a 19th century problem, right? So let's see what kind of things we can say about the answer. So for n equal 1, so we have the number. And this is known actually for the 19th century. It was very, very, very classical result, was known. Is this number. I mean, this for n equal 2, we also have the number. Actually, it was computed by Sheldon Katz around the 80s of the last century. So the problem is, okay, we have n equal 1, n equal 2. So what happened with n equal 3? So that problem is a little bit more complicated. And these algebraic geometers, Ehling's root and Strum, they compute the number. And they got this number there in red, right? The interesting thing in the story was that in 1991, these physicists, Candelas, de la Ossa-Green-Parkes, they wrote this paper, a pair of Calabi-Yau manifold as an exactly super conformal theory. And they also compute n equal to 3. But as you see, the number is different to the number obtained by algebraic geometers. So it was quite, you know, shocking, because they got a different number. So mathematicians thought that, okay, that is physics, so it should be wrong, no problem. Everything is okay. But then actually, n is greater than strong. They actually check their computer program and they realized that actually their answer was wrong. And the right answer is the answer given by physicists. So they wrote an email. This thing where they presented this to different computation was in a workshop, actually. I know this story because of Manning. Manning told me the story, but it's also, if you read the book by Zhao, the shape, the inner shape of space. So Zhao wrote about this story there. So they actually checked the program and they realized, okay, they say, okay, we were wrong. The right answer is the answer given by the physicists. And what's a little bit shocking for mathematicians, okay? How they got this answer? And the impact was bigger because actually Candelas de la Ossa-Green-Parkes, they don't use compute n equal to 3. They did more. Actually, they compute the number of rational numbers of degree up to 10. So they were able not just to answer the question for n equal to 3, but they say, okay, n equal to 4, 5, 7, 8, 9, and 10 should be this thing. And what they used was mirror symmetry. So they use this idea of mirror symmetry and compute the things. So what they did was the following thing. So they went to compute the number of rational curves, which actually now we know this is Gromov-Witten invariance. You know, roughly speaking, Gromov-Witten invariance are the number of rational curves. So they say, okay, we have this problem of counting this computing this Gromov-Witten invariance of counting this number of rational points for the quintic hypersurfing in CP4. Okay, that problem could be quite hard in this context. So let's go to the mirror. So computing Gromov-Witten invariance is a symplectic thing. That's the point. We only need to consider the symplectic geometry for the matter. So they say, okay, let's go to the mirror, consider the mirror partner of this, and then we can intercheck the symplectic geometry there by the complex geometry in the mirror. And in the complex side, what we need to compute is the periods of the mirror quintic. So they compute the Picard-Fuchs equation, they obtain the Picard-Fuchs equation, and they compute the periods, and they describe what is called the mirror map, and their mirror map relates the computation of the periods with the computation of the Gromov-Witten invariance. That's what they did. So they were able to convert the problem in this enumerative problem for X, it's kind of symplectic nature, in a complex geometry problem in the mirror. And they compute everything using solving the Picard-Fuchs equation. And that was actually surprising, right? So what is mirror symmetry again? So now we can say something more concrete about mirror symmetry. So again, we have a pair of Calabi-Yau varieties, X and X check. And I will call actually the symplectic side of story the A model and the complex side of the story B model. And mirror symmetry says something like, okay, you had this Gromov-Witten invariance, this theory of Gromov-Witten invariance in genus zero. So there's some technicality there. So you can define actually Gromov-Witten in arbitrary in genus, but then we just focus on genus zero, right? In fact, in the three-pointed Gromov-Witten invariant, that's what they did, right? But let me just say that, so in the A model, you have the Gromov-Witten theory, and in the B model, you have the Hodge theory of the mirror. So you can see the mirror symmetry as relating the Gromov-Witten theory with the Hodge theory of the mirror. So using Gromov-Witten theory, you can construct what is called the Frobenius manifold. It's not really important what the Frobenius manifold is right now, but you can get this kind of construction from the Gromov-Witten theory. And also from the Hodge theory, you can construct the Frobenius manifold. In fact, it's in the V model, you probably are more familiar with Hodge theory, is coming from the Gauss-Manning connection. So one thing you can say in the Gromov-Witten theory is that, you know, three-pointed Gromov-Witten invariants, in fact, the Gromov-Witten invariants are, you know, packaged in something which is called the quantum cohomology ring, right? And using the quantum cohomology ring, you can construct a connection, which is called the quantum connection or the quantum differential equation. So in this context, the quantum differential equation should be the Picard-Fuchs equation for the mirror somehow. That's the general thing. And that's a precise statement about mirror symmetry. So a two-paired Calabi-Yau will be mirror if the Frobenius manifold constructed from the Gromov-Witten theory of the A model is isomorphic to the Frobenius manifold of the mirror pair constructed by the Hodge theory of the V model. That will be one way to look at mirror symmetry. But of course, I mean, computing Gromov-Witten invariants is not an easy task, right? And then we want to know, the mathematician wanted to know if there is a more intrinsic way to understand mirror symmetry or not, right? And then we have the next step in the story. So we have, again, we can ask the question, what is mirror symmetry in a more precise way? And we have a third approach, and this is a categorical approach. So you see the original paper was in 1991. That was somehow the beginning of the mathematical theory of mirror symmetry. That's why we are celebrating 30 years this year. And in 1994, just 3 years after that paper, so Concevich, in his ICM talk, proposed a big program about mirror symmetry. What is the idea? So Concevich look at the conjecture, the mirror symmetry conjecture in the Candelas de la Ossa-Green-Parkes setting, and he saw that actually what is related there is the string clause. The clause strings are the one involved in this setting. I mean, this was actually known before. So the point is that we have this kind of Riemann surfaces, possibly with boundary, and in using that context, we can get this A model and B model coming from Gromov-Witten theory and Hodge theory, I mean, actually variation of Hodge structures. So that's good. So we can actually ask, how about with open strings? If we don't have, so if we can admit surfaces with corners, so we can get something from considering open strings instead of closed strings, and we do. Now what we have is that if we consider open strings, we can construct from the A side what is called the Fukaya category, which is really a symplectic object. It's not easy to define actually. It's still somehow open the question how to define in a right way a Fukaya category. And we can construct this object. And in the V side, we can construct the Dirac category of coherent chips, the bonded Dirac category of coherent chief of the X mu. That's the construction we get, considering these brains. And what Concevich proposed in his ICM talk was that we can consider mirror symmetry as equivalence between categories. So that is called homological mirror symmetry. So if you have a pair of Calabi-Yau manifolds or varieties, X and X check, so you can consider the Fukuya category of X, and you can consider the Dirac category of coherent chiefs of X check. You can do also the other way around. So you can construct the Fukuya category for X check and the Dirac category of X and the Fukuya category of X check. And they're also derived equivalents. So what is hard to prove that, okay, so you have that, you can put a triangulated structure in the Fukuya category, and you can put that. So naturally, the Dirac category is a triangulated category, and you have these equivalences as a triangulated categories. Again, you have to be more precise, right? Probably you need to take probably some derived Fukuya category or some bounded derived Fukuya category. So there are some technicalities there, but essentially what you have is this relation between the Fukuya category and the Dirac category of coherent chiefs. And that's homological mirror symmetry, okay? But still, it's in the same philosophy as the beginning. So Fukuya category is some symplectic geometry object, and the Dirac category of coherent chiefs is a complex or algebraic geometry object. So again, this mirror symmetry is also related to complex and symplectic geometry, but in a categorical way, right? And that was the second approach to mirror symmetry, right? It's supposed that if you have this the equivalence between the Dirac categories, so the isomorphism between the Frobenius manifolds coming from Gromov-Witten theory and Hall's theory should be whole, right? So this homological mirror symmetry actually should imply let me call this the classical mirror symmetry, right? But there is one problem with these two approaches. So you see, they are not so geometric in some sense. So you actually need to know you actually need to know the mirror pair. So because if you see they say, okay, if you have an X and you have F check and they are mirrored, so the Dirac categories, we have this equivalent between the Dirac categories, so you have this isomorphism between Frobenius manifold structures. But how to get the mirror partner? That's the point, right? So there is this third approach to mirror symmetry. So again, we can formulate what is mirror symmetry. I will have this fourth approach to mirror symmetry, which appeared in this paper by Strominger, Yao, and Saslow in 1996, just 5 years. You see, actually very five exciting years. So Candelas de la Ossa published the paper in 1991. In 1994, Concevich came with this homological mirror symmetry program. And in 1996, actually, Strominger, Yao, Saslow came with the SYZ conjecture, which is also another program to understand mirror symmetry using 5 years. So that was, and you see there are big names involved, like Yao, Concevich, etc. It was actually, you know, the impact of the Candelas de la Ossa computation was really big in the mathematical community, right? It was kind of very, probably at the beginning somehow shocking, but then was kind of, people get excited about that. They say, okay, there is something really interested in this physics these people are doing, and then we should really understand that physics from the mathematical point of view. That's really nice, you know? So I just open a window. So many students in mathematics, they don't like physics. They say, oh, okay, I don't want to take courses in physics because, my physics is boring. I don't need physics to do mathematics. Okay, probably this story about mirror symmetry, okay, invites people to think about it. And probably, let me put that way, physics has something to say in mathematics, I think. Let's see. So they have this approach to mirror symmetry, and they said mirror symmetry is the duality. What is the point? So just consider some base, some space B, which is the base, and then consider two torus vibrations, right? So the same base, but two torus vibration. So mirror symmetry will be the following in that constant. So these vibrations, mu and mu check, are fiberwise dual to each other. They are dual to right. That's the point. So you have this torus vibration in one side, and you have this other torus vibration, and the fibers are dual. So the total space of the vibrations are mirrored to each other. So there's a very geometric way to construct mirror symmetry, right? Of course, it's not a trivial way, it's not a trivial thing to construct a torus vibration. That's the point. But you know, this is a very, 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 very geometric approach. So you can ask, okay, good. You have the base, you have the vibrations, etc. So how I can see the relation between symplectic and complex geometry in this setting? It's not probably that clear. But it is. So that somehow, because in the conjecture, they also conjecture that there should be kind of Fourier Mukai fiberwise transform. We actually intersect the symplectic geometry data on X and the complex geometry on X check, and vice versa, right? So the philosophy now is the following. So is the following, that in this approach, mirror symmetry is a Fourier transform. That's very nice. That is very interesting. So in a very general setting, so you can just consider mirror symmetry as a kind of a Fourier transform, but also this SYZ conjecture gives you an idea how to construct the mirror dual of X, but you have to construct this fiberwise dualizing a special Lagrangian torus vibration. It's not really easy to do, but you get some geometric way to construct the mirror. So in 5 years after Candelas-de la Ossa paper, so we got two big programs for mirror symmetry: homological mirror symmetry, this Concevich categorical approach, and this SYZ conjecture, which is kind of more geometric approach. And these two programs are quite open right now. So there's a lot of activity in SYZ conjecture and also in the homological mirror conjecture, right? So that's the point. So let's see what can we say about these two things. So in 2023, Gross and Sieber, they came with a program. So they wanted to understand this SYZ conjecture. So they say, okay, let's see how we can get an algebraic analog of this SYZ conjecture. And it's something very, 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 very nice here, right? So his idea was actually to use toric degenerations to construct the mirror dual of Calabi-Yau varieties. But they somehow, you know, we have this idea at the beginning of the mirror symmetry was we have the A model. Just let me consider the symplectic geometry. You have the V model, the complex geometry. You have this relation between these two things. But what Gross and Sieber proposed is that, okay, there is this intermediate world called the tropical geometry. You know, tropical is because of Brazil. Maybe you don't know the story, but the tropical thing actually was discovered by some Brazilian computer scientists. And some French said, okay, that ring is quite interesting, and it was, you know, formed by a Brazilian, so tropical, that's it, okay. Probably, I don't know, maybe today is not really, you know, politically correct to put this kind of names, but that time was probably people was different and it was okay. But probably today people you know, get upset with these kind of things, you know. But anyway, it's quite a nice name, tropical geometry. But is that we have this tropical, but this tropical geometry in between the A model and B model. That's the idea. So what Gross-Silver did was to propose that, okay, in fact, there is also probably here, I didn't put that, but probably here you have also an intermediate word that is this log geometry. You can also put this log geometry here also. This log geometry, you can put it log geometry. Yeah, also, right? So that's very interesting. So the idea of Gross and Silver, how to construct using this tropical approach, how to construct the mirror dual of a Calabi-Yau. So you give me a Calabi-Yau, how to construct the mirror. And they say, okay, we can use this tropical approach. And again, Gross-Silver program from 2003 has been, you know, developed a lot, and there is a lot of work in Gross-Silver program by Gross and Silver and themselves and also students. It's also an open and quite interested area in mirror symmetry. You see, this is 2023. This is 12 years or after the mirror, so the paper by Candelas de la Ossa-Green-Parkes. So there was a lot of things there. Good. Questions? So we can go beyond Calabi-Yau varieties. So far, I have been describing mirror symmetry for Calabi-Yau varieties. But somehow we have these three classes of varieties. So we have these Calabi-Yau varieties, the canonical, the trivial canonical bundle. You have the final varieties, and you have varieties of general type. So the point is that we can go beyond Calabi-Yau varieties. For example, we can consider Fano varieties like Grassmannians, projective spaces, etc. So the question is, the answer was yes, also from the 90s. I didn't put here the dates, but it was actually developed in parallel to the Calabi-Yau story. So the answer was yes, but this is an interesting phenomenon for Fano varieties. If you take a Calabi-Yau, so the mirror of a Calabi-Yau, of n-dimensional Calabi-Yau, is another n-dimensional Calabi-Yau manifold. But for Fano, an interesting phenomenon appears, because the mirror of the Fano is not a Fano. It's what is called a Landau-Ginzburg model. So what is a Landau-Ginzburg model? Is this pair, YW, where Y is a non-compact Calabi-Yau, and W is just a function from the Y to C, or it's called the potential. You can think, as an example, just consider, for example, CP2, the projective plane, the complex projective plane. So you just consider, let me put this here. You can consider CP2. CP2. You can consider CP2. So the mirror for CP2 will be this polynomial, which is the Laurent polynomial, which actually is a function between this Laurent polynomial W. This W actually comes from the torus to C, the dimensional torus to C. In fact, actually, you can think of this mirror of Fano as a Laurent polynomial. Probably. Of course, I mean, if the Fano historic Fano, there is a kind of folklore idea that the mirror will be Laurent polynomial. Maybe it's not toric, it should be something different, but you can think in the toric case, like it's CP2, and then you can consider the mirror as a Laurent polynomial. In fact, the mirror is not, the mirror described that way is not unique. This is the different, other Laurent polynomials can appear as mirror, but they are all related by a birational transformation of the cluster type. This actually was done by Sergei Galkin and myself. We described this in the case of del peso surfaces. But also this idea is in Hick, is in Hacking, Kill, Gross, and Concevich paper. Probably what Concevich, Hacking, Kill, and Gross did was more, you know, it's bigger than what Sergei and I did, but somehow the same philosophy, right? So this is the point with Fanon manifolds. So we have this Laurent, we have this Landau-Gisbourg model to mirror to the Fanon variety. But again, the question is what mirror means in this setting, right? You have, so the point is that you have everything as before. So you have also, but okay, before this, so you have also here, you can construct a Frobenius manifold coming from the quantum cohomology, the Gromov-Witten theory of CPN. So you can consider the Gromov-Witten theory of the Fanon variety. So you, for the Landau-Gisbourg model, you can consider somehow some other Frobenius manifold structure and up to some things that are isomorphic. You also have homological mirror symmetry. I will describe this later. So you have also SYZ conjecture for Fanon. So the three pictures of mirror symmetry I described with the right modifications applies to the Fanon case. So like in the Calabi-Yau, you have this Gromov-Witten variation of Hausdorff structures mirror symmetry. You also have the homological mirror symmetry. You have also the SYZ conjecture, but also you need to make some modifications because you need to consider something in the Landau-Gisbourg side. You have to be more precise about what the structures are in the Landau-Gisbourg side. So in fact, there is this paper by Concevich, Katsarkov, and Pantev, 2008, right? And this paper, the title is Host Theoretic Aspects of Mirror Symmetry. And in that paper, they introduced a very, very interesting idea of non-commutative Hausch structure. The non-commutative Hausch structures are somehow the extension of Hausch structures and variation of Hausch structures. Let me say that way from the Calabi-Yau case to the Fanon case. So what you have when you have the Calabi-Yau case, so you essentially have the Picard-Fuchs equation. So the Picard-Fuchs equation is a differential equation with only regular singularities, right? But when you consider the Fanon case, so the quantum cohomology differential equation essentially is not regular. It has two singular points. It's regular at zero, but irregular at infinity. It's a pole of order two, right? So the idea of non-commutative Hausch structures is to consider also these kind of connections when you have these two irregular points. You have irregular point at zero and irregular point at infinity, but this infinity is a regular point of order, it's a pole of order two. So it's something we actually can control. And I will back again to this idea in a few seconds, right? And then, so you can see the mirror symmetry now, not as an isomorphic just as a Frobenius manifold, but as an isomorphy between the non-commutative Hausch structures related. But we can extend this first approach to mirror symmetry relating Gromov-Witten theory and variation of Hausch structures. Now, so in the A side, you have a non-commutative Hausch structure coming from the Gromov-Witten theory. On the other side, you also have a non-commutative Hausch structure, and you can match these two things. So you can also consider a non-commutative Hausch structure for the Landau-Gisbourg model, right? Of course, this point of view covers the classical Calabi-Yau situation, and it's really interesting. So in fact, to get to compute the non-commutative Hausch structures, and especially to see that there is a rational structure in this context of mirror symmetry is a really, really interesting problem. And I will back again to this problem, and there are also a lot of open problems there. So in 2008, we have this paper, And also we have a have the homological mirror symmetry was actually proposed in the 90s. So we have that the direct category of coherent chief of X is related, but now with the Fukaya-Seidel category of the Landau-Gisbert model. So we need to modify the idea of the Fukaya category, and we get this is what is called Fukaya-Seidel category, and then we get this homological, this relation between these two between these two categories, and it's also a relation between triangulated categories. So that's interesting. Okay, so for people like me, so we actually find that in the final case, the Dirac category of coherent chief is very interesting for the final. So the Dirac category appearing here in the homological mirror symmetry is very interesting. And it's very interesting because we have what is called Dubrovin conjectures. Somehow homological mirror symmetry in this setting actually implies the Dubrovin conjecture. So what is the Dubrovin conjecture? So the Dubrovin conjecture was proposed in 1998, so we back 10 years. And then again, so the idea was that the Dubrovin conjecture said that the Gromov-Witten theory of X here is interesting because here is using in one side of the mirror. This is not a mirror statement in the strict sense, right? So this is actually the Gromov-Witten theory of X, and the right category of X somehow, or the right. So we are in the same side of the mirror in this case. So what in more concrete terms, what the Dubrovin conjecture said was that you consider final manifolds, you can consider this big quantum cohomology, which actually is with quantum cohomologies of Frobenius manifolds, so encode all the genus zero Gromov-Witten invariants. So this is semi-simple. It's an algebra. This means a sum of the, or generically semi-simple, it's a sum of the field. If and only if you consider the Dirac category of coherent chief of the manifold, you have the existence of a full exceptional collection. That is really, you know, it's really very surprising because, you know, for one side you have this Gromov-Witten, which is kind of enumerative, symplectic, blah, blah, blah thing. And here you have this complex thing that is complex algebraic object, which is the Dirac category of coherent chiefs. And why we actually relate semi-simplicity of quantum cohomology with full exceptional collection. Okay, this is actually is a consequence somehow of homological mirror symmetry. The most important thing is that okay, this monodromy data of the semi-simple quantum cohomology. Remember that they say that the connection has a pole of order two. So in the pole of order two, we have this Stokes phenomenon. So we relate two solutions of the differential equation around that point. The solutions don't live in the full plane, but using sectors. And when you want to look at how the solution behaves when two sectors overlap, so you see that the solutions are related by the matrix, and this is the Stokes matrix. So we have the monodromy data now is given by the Stokes matrices, but the Stokes matrices actually can be obtained from the categorical data coming from the direct category, and that's the Dubrovin conjecture. So the Dubrovin conjecture can be proved for projective spaces. There are some work by Dubrovin for CP2, by Gussetti for general CPN. There was also another proof by Baris van der Put and myself. We also reproved this Dubrovin conjecture for CPN. And there is also some work by Dubrovin, Gussetti, and Cotti, and they prove actually Dubrovin conjecture for the Grassmannian. There are some interested in this. I had to be more precise. Here I probably had to put 1998-2018. Why? Because if you look at the paper by Dubrovin, the third part of the Dubrovin conjecture was not really precise in that paper. It took 20 years until 2018 to to really get the precise formulation of the conjecture. You see how the conjecture is highly non-trivial, because it took 20 years just to formulate the conjecture in the right words. So the people actually, they speculate and things, and they made a lot of speculation, there should be this and this and this and this, and but the precise formulation, it took 20 years. Actually, I have to be honest. Now, I mean, we are, you know, among friends, and also this will be in YouTube, doesn't matter. But I think I need to review my result with Marius van der Put, because maybe it's not, I mean, it's not that what we get is wrong, but maybe we need to do some refinement of our results to get more precise relation between the right categories and the one of the data we computed. Because when we did this work, we considered a kind of rough version of the Dubrovin conjecture. But after this 2018 paper, I realized, okay, so maybe we need to take care about something there and to write in a more precise way our results. It's not that the results are right, but could be written better. That's what I want to say. And the idea is that we can write better is because now we know better the conjecture. That's the point, right? But this is knives. This is mathematics. You know, that's the thing we do. That's mathematics. So we go back and we try things, and sometimes we for 20 years we think that we have the right approach, but suddenly we see, okay, no, probably it was not right. That's good. So that's very good. So that's a highly non-trivial conjecture coming from mirror symmetry, homological mirror symmetry. So that's good. So and I really, so my work actually now is focused on this kind of conjecture, right? Then what next? So what other things we can do with mirror symmetry? So there are many other ways to explore. For example, I just consider Calabi-Yau manifolds, and I consider just Fano. But you can ask, okay, what happened with varieties of general type? Okay, there is a mirror symmetry for varieties of general type. So there are some studies by Gross, Katsarkov, Aro, and other people. They consider the mirror symmetry for general type. Is the picture is of course more complicated than in the Fano case and in the Calabi-Yau case, but there are some works in that direction. There is also this intrinsic mirror symmetry program. Also, it's a program by Gross and Sieber. So this kind of, let's say, somehow reformulation of his program. So now they have a more precise way to construct these mirror partners using some ideas, you know, coming from, again, from tropical geometry and his old program. That these two papers in last year, probably the first one was 2016 and the other one was from this last year, and they proposed this intrinsic mirror symmetry construction. There is also this global mirror symmetry program. So I didn't say this thing, but somehow mirror symmetry relates to kind of moduli spaces. So you have for one side the moduli space of complex deformation, and on the other side, in the A side, you have the Keller deformation, right? But mirror symmetry is, you can see mirror symmetry is a kind of isomorphy, not between these two moduli spaces, but a neighborhood, you know, in the Keller moduli with the complex moduli. But what happens is mirror symmetry is a local phenomenon around a maximally unipotent monodromy point. That's the thing, right? But you can consider other points, and you can move from other points. And there is this program by Iritani, Ruan, Kyodo, and other people that consider moving to other points, not just around the maximally unipotent monodromy point, and get some mirror symmetry. And this is what they call global mirror symmetry, because you not consider what happened locally around the maximally monodromy, unipotent monodromy point, but also around other points. All, you know, this work by Candelas, de la Ossa, etc., happened in this local setting, but we can have this global mirror symmetry. These three things are things I am interested in. There is also a lot of work related mirror symmetry with the geometric Laplace dual. If you look at this, the literature, and you look at the Witten, Frankel papers, there are some kind of mirror symmetry related with the Laplace geometric Laplace program. Also, there is something people call 3D mirror symmetry, and in this 3D mirror symmetry, the geometric representation theory plays an important role. So there are a lot of things to do. So what I wanted to show you is that there is a rich story behind mirror symmetry, but we are far from actually understanding that phenomenon. I think that somehow many interesting mathematics during this century, the 21st century, will be around mirror symmetry. And that's it. So I just finish here saying that this is the, you know, and this was actually a very general overview of what happened since 30 years ago. And I hope probably we can meet again in 30 years and say, okay, what is going on? And probably I should report some of your results in mirror symmetry during the next 30 years. So thanks for the invitation and thanks for listening to the talk.
Okay, really nice, John Alexander. So let's thank the speaker for this great overview about mirror symmetry. It was really nice.